What if marketing was 100% responsible for the elimination order of Universe 7? If headcanon, storytelling, and everything else was put aside? Well, to answer your thoughts, alrighty guys, it is Quaman here today, also known as Detective Q, and I'll be having this fun theory with you today using both college and Dragon Ball experience to explain how marketing could completely affect the elimination order of Universe 7, and this is going to be a fun theory that I put a lot of thought into. So without wasting any more time, let's get straight into this video. So, with everybody talking about the elimination order of Dragon Ball Super, the first thing we have to do is actually define how marketing can impact sales. The more exposure a character gets of screen time relates to how likely a person will be to buy merchandise of that particular character. And when you factor in more things like transformations and new moves, that can also drastically increase sales. And what I should also add is that a unique personality and relationships to other characters can also impact a character's ability to sell. So with adding all of those things, I'm going to purely analyze this objectively as to how all characters would rank. So, the first category I organized into this marketing theory would have to be the throwback characters. And coming in at number 10, I have Tien. Now, Tien in theory is arguably the most bland and expendable character in the Tournament of Power, and I'm being very unbiased here, I like Tien's character, but when you compare Tien's personality and his abilities, we don't really get anything new out of him as compared to the other characters that we've seen. And Tien is often known as an introverted character who is not as interactive with the other Dragon Ball Super characters in the show itself, so when you really think about it, what unique ability, transformation, or personality are we really getting out of Tien? He's one of those throwback characters that we've known for years that just joins in the fight to help Universe 7 win, which makes him the most expendable, so if marketing affected this, he would be the first to go. Now, next on the list, we have Krillin. Now, obviously, Krillin falls into this throwback category as well because, like Tien, he's also one of those throwback Dragon Ball characters that has been with the show or the series for so long, and when you factor in Krillin, he really didn't have any new abilities other than his new Solar Flare times 100 or his Taioken times 100. And when you also think about it, the only reason I gave him an edge over Tien was because of the fact that Krillin over the years has been shown to be a more popular character than Tien because of his relationship with Goku. And when you also factor in that in all of the build-up to the Tournament of Power, that Krillin had much more exposure as he was having those training episodes with Goku and friends, this all suggests that the Dragon Ball Super series wanted to hype up Krillin a lot more than Tien. So Krillin would definitely be the second character of this whole throwback list. And then let's move on to the next character. Coming in at number 8, we have Master Roshi. Now, Master Roshi is a very unique character on this list because he's a perverted old man and he can't fly, but that doesn't really matter because in the Tournament of Power you can't really fly anyways. And when you think about it, Master Roshi's personality is vastly different from Krillin and Tien. So personality is something here, and then when you also factor in appearance, Master Roshi with those huge jacked up muscles would definitely be, I guess you could say, a good marketing tool to sell toys to kids who want to buy this old man with shades that has jacked up muscles. So Master Roshi's appearance, his personality, and the fact that having an old throwback character for Master Roshi is actually more interesting than Tien and Krillin because he hasn't fought as much as them, basically puts him over both of his students and Krillin and Tien. But if I'm going to be 100% unbiased, guys, 100% unbiased, I'm going to pit Piccolo as the top of the throwback character list coming in at number 7. Now, here's the thing, guys. I love Piccolo as a character. He's my favorite character in the series, but when you compare him to the others, Piccolo is different from all of the other humans because he's obviously a Namekian, and when you also factor in that Piccolo has had more exposure than some of these characters, when you factor in that he was the one who was retraining Gohan, he was the one who was saying how he and Gohan wanted to practice tag team moves together, and he was also a part of that sparring match between Goku, Gohan, Piccolo himself, and Tien. So when you really think about it, they're definitely using Piccolo as more of a mentor role, so that's why I would put him at the top of the throwback character list. And in terms of power, he can simply just last longer, and being green definitely makes his appearance different from others. So I would put Piccolo at the top of the throwback characters, but honestly, when you really think about it, these four characters are so old, and they don't really bring that much new to the table that they're more expendable than the other characters that I'm about to mention. Let's talk about the wildcard characters. Now, we have both Android 17 and Android 18, and I would start off Android 18 with number 6. Now, here's the thing. If I looked at this purely from a marketing perspective, Android 18 was associated with two characters, so that definitely puts her above some of the other characters on this list. She was associated with Krillin, and she's also associated with Android 17. And when you also think about it, guys, this has nothing to do with gender, but it does have to do with marketing. Android 18 is a female character, and to tell you the honest truth, being the only female character in a team of nothing but men and aliens does set you apart, and if you really think about it. And the fact that Krillin was already eliminated first, this immediately tells me that from a marketing point of view, that we have to narrow down our points and say that if Krillin was already eliminated first, this now means that the show wants her to last longer with Android 17. And that takes me into my next point. With Android 17, he has one thing going for him. As we've seen so far in the Dragon Ball series, the only real thing that sets 17 apart from 18 in terms of abilities from what we've seen is the Android barrier, and that's really something that 18 could potentially do. We just never saw her actually using it in the show. So in terms of abilities, he's virtually just a male version of Android 18. He's a stronger version of Android 18, and when you think about the fact that Android 17 hasn't been in the show for so long, it wouldn't make sense to wipe him out that early. And he did have those two episodes with Goku where they were fighting against poachers, which definitely means that his level of exposure is definitely higher than some of the throwback characters. So Android 17 and Android 18 are what I would call the wildcard characters, that I would put them right in the middle. They're definitely not at the top tier, but they're definitely in the middle tier of this list, and they could possibly be eliminated at any point, but I'll put them in the middle. And last but not least, guys, we have the untouchables. And what I mean by untouchables are characters that have all of the marketing potential in the world. These characters are fan favorite characters. These characters have transformations. These characters are the sole reason that drives marketing in this franchise. And coming in at number 4, I have Vegeta. Now, I originally thought about putting Vegeta higher on this list, but I was talking to Geekdom 101 about this list. And the thing that he was talking about is that in terms of the way the show has been showing characters being grouped together, it definitely seems like Vegeta's kind of different from the other three characters that I'm about to mention. However, when you factor in that Vegeta does have the ability to transform, when you factor in that Vegeta is a rival of the main character of the show, that immediately puts him in a completely different marketing class. And when you also think about it, Dragon Ball Super Vegeta has had so much exposure in terms of marketing just strictly from the series outside of the Tournament of Power. So before the Tournament of Power even started, he was one of the primary characters, which makes him a key marketing tool in all of this. And when you move on to number 3, Gohan, in my opinion, gets a slight edge over Vegeta. Now, Geekdom actually argued that Gohan would be higher, but my reason for putting Gohan at number 3 would be solely because of the fact that Gohan could possibly and potentially transform and get a new transformation. So you have to put characters with transformations in a completely different category than everybody else, because they can transform, which means that they can have more merchandise options. And for Gohan, what I think you should also think about is that he has had a lot of exposure in all of these Tournament of Power build-up episodes. And even if you look at Dragon Ball Super before this Tournament of Power, they've been hyping up Gohan coming back for so long. So I think in terms of having a character getting back into the action, getting back into the fighting, possibly getting a new transformation if Super wants to go down that line, Gohan seems like a prime candidate. And the biggest evidence of this is the fact that Goku made him the captain of Universe 7, so they're clearly planning on doing something with Gohan here. And next we have Goku. Now, You could argue Goku being lower than Gohan in terms of potential, but the thing is, Goku's the main character of the series, and there was that whole promotional thing of Goku having this new transformation. So, in theory, the way I look at this is, because Goku's the main character of the show, that immediately puts him virtually above everybody else. That new transformation suggests something. In addition to this, a lot of people have been speculating about that outro potentially saying that Goku and Gohan are going to be the last characters to stand fighting. And if you really think about it, in terms of power, Universe 7 really doesn't stand a shot if Goku doesn't last very long. So, it's safe to put Goku at number 2. Now, hear me out. There's a lot of reasons to suggest Frieza being the number one marketing tool of this team. First of all, Frieza having a halo makes him immediately different from all of the merchandise that we've had of Frieza so far. So by having a halo, Frieza is immediately a new type of merchandise toy without doing anything else to his appearance. When you also factor in that Frieza, like the other three characters I mentioned in this untouchable group, he is a character who can transform, which definitely means that he can also give you more merchandise options. And also, the number one reason of all, Frieza is a villain who is coming back to fight alongside heroes, which means that that by itself, and because he stands out so much because of his relationship with all of the characters on this list, that immediately puts Frieza in a completely different category, even above Goku, Gohan, and Vegeta, because of how original and awkward it is for him to be in this scenario in the Tournament of Power. So ultimately, I would have to say that Frieza is by far the number one marketing tool of this entire arc. He's the wild card, and if you really want to think about it in terms of marketing, it was a much smarter option in terms of business to put Frieza over Majin Buu, even if story-wise it doesn't make sense. But if there's one thing I feel should definitely stand in this video, it would be the categories instead of the specific rankings. Even if you agree with some characters being above each other, like possibly Vegeta being above Gohan or Goku being above everybody else, that's perfectly fine. However, the categories of being an untouchable, a wild card, and a throwback character really honestly dictated the way I categorized this video for you guys. And let me know all of your thoughts in the comment section below. So with everything else said, please remember to rate, comment, and subscribe. And remember, as I always say, to have a great day, guys. And for a thank you, I wanted to thank Geekdom 101 and Android 18 for actually discussing some of the things that made me influence this video today.